The cliched image of the Highland clans is one of failed romantic heroes, sacrificing everything for a doomed but idealistic cause.
But that was not the story for every clan, and certainly not the story for Clan Grant. Shrewd and businesslike, the Grants were astute politicians and pragmatists and knew exactly how to exploit every opportunity, and they would do whatever it took to promote and protect their position, whether that meant betraying their own clansfolk or making a fortune from the slave trade.
In this series, I'm going on a personal journey, uncovering the stories behind the family names that have shaped our nation. Names that many of us either share or know day to day, because in Scotland, understanding clan roots gives a unique and personal insight into our collective history. Grant is one of the best known Scottish names, but it's also a clan with a controversial history. By the end of the 18th century, the Grants were one of the wealthiest families in Scotland, with extensive estates in the northeast. They got to the top by being politically astute and were highly capable land managers. They've been recognised in Scottish history for their role in driving ahead agricultural reforms and planting forests. But there's another side to Grant clan history that's less celebrated.
In this university library is a very intriguing academic book that depicts one of the Grant coat of arms. Now, it's not an image you're likely to see fluttering from any flagpole or for sale in a Scottish gift shop. And it's not a coat of arms you expect from a clan with its roots in the Highlands. On the one side is a clansman in full Highland costume, and on the other side is a semi-naked Negro. Now, this is an image that makes many people feel uncomfortable, because the Grant, who commissioned this coat of arms, ran one of the biggest slaving stations in the British Empire.
The Wilberforce Institute in Hull is one of the leading centres for the study of Britain's involvement in the slave trade. Dr. Douglas Hamilton has researched the Grant slaving empire.
Douglas, can you give me an indication of the scale of Grant involvement in the slave trade?
They were very heavily involved at all sorts of levels. One of the leading figures was Sir Alexander Grant of Dalveigh, who was a partner in a business that owned an island just off the coast of Africa, from where they shipped something like 11,000 Africans to work on the plantations. Eventually, he came to own plantations in the Caribbean. His kinsman, Sir Archibald Grant of Monymusk, also owned plantations in Jamaica, as well as some in East Florida.
Why was the slave trade such an attractive option to a clan like the Grants?
Because it was an opportunity to make money really quite quickly, so that they could return home to use the money to advance their position or to improve their estates or to build new houses. To run plantations across the Atlantic, you need to have people who you trust. There are no easy communications in the 18th century. There are no email, there are no planes. So you have to be able to send people you trust, and the people that are trusted most are close family members, cousins, uncles, nephews, that sort of thing.
So in a sense, the clan system has been transplanted from the Highlands to the Caribbean.
Yes, that's right. Under the clanship system, there was also an idea that clan leaders had a responsibility to provide opportunities for younger members of their clan.
What kind of conditions would the slaves have experienced in Jamaica?
Really pretty atrocious. They did extremely hard work in the plantations, producing sugar, which is really the main commodity. And they were made to work under these incredibly difficult conditions, but with the threat of violence hanging over them all the time. So the average life expectancy for a young, fit African man arriving off a slave ship would be 7 years at best.
And that's really no more than a death sentence.
It's absolutely a death sentence.
Was there any sense that, from the Grants themselves, that perhaps they might have been involved in an activity that, to say the very least, was rather dubious in its morality?
No, I don't think they did think it was in any way immoral. The public campaigns for the abolition of the slave trade and slavery hadn't begun at this point, And people really weren't thinking that enslaving Africans was immoral. For the most part, people didn't think of Africans as being human beings. So it was really all right to make them work in this way and for them to be traded in this way.
And I suppose it's important to remember that the Grants were not the only Scottish family making money out of the slave trade.
No, they were just one of many. I think it's probably true to say that most major families in Scotland had some kind of connection with the Caribbean, whether it's directly or indirectly.
The Grants and their empire in Jamaica was considered a model of how to do things. And you're acquiring wealth beyond even the clan chief's expectations. It's the model of how to get on.
You get something of an idea as to how far the Grant name has spread across the globe. If you look in a Jamaican phone book, amongst the hundreds of Scottish names you'll find in it are pages and pages of Grants.
The name Grant is quite common in the West Indies because in 1834 we banned slavery in those islands. And slaves were never allowed to have a surname or be baptised. It's part of the subjugation. So most slaves took the name of the previous owner. So if you've been belonging to an estate belonging to the Grants, then you would probably take the surname Grant.
But the Grant story does have an interesting twist to it. The money they made from the slave trade was largely ploughed back into Scotland. One of the most successful Grant plantation owners, Archibald Grant of Monymusk, used his wealth to finance radical farming reforms, which hugely benefited 18th century Scotland. And he's gone down in history as the country's greatest agricultural improver.
The key to Archibald Grant's success was this, the humble turnip. Now, the turnip may not be the most glamorous of crops, but when it was discovered that neeps enriched the soil, it caused an agricultural revolution.
The turnip was just one of a whole package of reforms that Archibald introduced to improve farming practice. As well as pioneering new crops and rotations, he encouraged tenants to enclose their fields and improve their husbandry. He also planted some 2 million trees, which made him one of the greatest tree planters of 18th century Scotland. The current Sir Archibald has offered to show me around the estate in Aberdeenshire, where his ancestor developed his new farming techniques.
So this is the great Sir Archibald himself. And what age is he there?
He's in his 30s.
What kind of man was Sir Archibald?
He was a man of tremendous energy. He said about one of his wives, "My wife is a dreadful slug of bed. It is oft 6 in the morning ere she rises." I mean, of course, they all got up at 4 or something like that.
Sir Archibald undoubtedly led the way in agricultural improvement in 18th century Scotland. He was a man driven by a fierce determination to fundamentally reshape his estate.
This is the map, dated 1774, and it shows the improvements that Sir Archibald had carried out. We have the house here, and then you have his experimental farm down at East Mains.
And in the past, all this area would have been covered by these small kind of crofting townships, these narrow strips of land, unenclosed, but he swept all that away and created this modern landscape.
Absolutely. It was the biggest change ever since people started to settle the land 5,000 years ago.
But in a sense, it's probably true to say that this map is not just a map of the estate, it's also a map of the vision that Sir Archibald had.
He just wanted people to be able to lift themselves out of the rut, out of the mire. He wanted to let people see that there was an alternative way.
And the tenants, were they reluctant or enthusiastic about embracing these changes?
They were very loath to take up the changes. But however, when they saw what happened on his experimental farm, the ideas were gradually adopted. He gave them Christmas presents. It was a packet of turnip seeds, but it was still a Christmas present.
So up on the roof, and well, the view definitely repays the effort. It's fantastic.
Yes.
It seems that Sir Archibald was really quite a complex character because on the one hand, he's involved in the great agricultural reform, but on the other side, he was involved in the somewhat unsavoury business of the slave trade. But what do you think about that personally?
Well, I think that one needs to judge people by the morals of the time. What he did then was perfectly normal in those days. Of course, it's not acceptable these days. And I feel that one just can't judge him using today's morality on what they did then.
He's an enlightened man by his own standards. The fact that you would see that is a contrary to hypocrisy, to owning slaves, it wouldn't occur to him, not at all. He belongs, he's a new man of a new age.
By the end of the 18th century, the Grants, with their lands in Strathspey and Aberdeenshire, had come a long way since their arrival in Scotland in the 13th century. Some claim that the Grants were originally Norse, but most historians believe the Grants were of Norman stock. Whatever their origins, the Grants realised right from the start of their time in Scotland the importance of cooperating with the Crown and being on the winning side. They established themselves in the northeast, and by the start of the 16th century, their steadfast service to the Scottish monarchy was rewarded.
The Crown recognised in the Grants a clan that could be trusted, and in 1509, the Grants were given Urquhart Castle, one of the most strategically important castles in Scotland.
Urquhart Castle lies on the northern shores of Loch Ness, guarding the Great Glen. It was vital for the Crown that whoever held Urquhart could be relied upon to keep rebellious local clans under control.
For a long period of time, Urquhart Castle was occupied by the Grant family, the Grant clan.
The castle saw its final action in 1689,
when this Grant garrison held off a much larger Jacobite force.
With Crown favour, the Grants were able to consolidate their position in the Highlands, where Castle Grant in Strathspey, surrounded by fertile farming land, became the clan seat. But the biggest advantage the Grants had was an untapped resource that even as late as the 1600s hadn't yet been exploited. Vast woodlands.
From the 17th century, the chiefs were seeing their land much more in marketable terms, from the commodities that were on them rather than the people.
They owned huge areas of forest like Abernethy and Rothiemurchus. And when the building boom took off in the late 1600s, the Grants made sure they efficiently exploited this very valuable asset.
Maintaining Grant forests was a very important and serious business, and any behaviour that threatened this valuable asset was simply not tolerated. In 1696, a young man who was caught burning heather near the woods received a punishment he'd never forget. He was nailed by the ear to the gallows.
Grant forests were full of Scots pine, ideal for shipmasts and house building. Cutting the trees down was a simple enough task, but at this time Strathspey was a very remote part of Scotland, and transporting the timber was a real challenge. But the Grants harnessed another natural asset to overcome this hurdle, the River Spey. The cut timber would be lashed together and steered downstream like a raft. This was a highly skilled and potentially very dangerous occupation. Forestry Commission expert Phil Whitfield has researched the life of the Spey floaters.
It was a pretty hairy job. At the height of the floating, there was probably around 90 to 100 people involved in just floating. But it was a very demanding job where the rafts were bound together. It wasn't a loose float of loose logs, and floated down the Spey all the way from Nethy Bridge right the way down to Kingston. Took between 12 and 16 hours, which is pretty fast going. If you imagine being bound to a lump of logs, travelling at that kind of speed down the Spey and being unable to manoeuvre it very much. That's what these guys did.
Looking at the fast-flowing river, it doesn't take much imagination to see that it could be a pretty hazardous task. But in a bid to get a first-hand experience of what it must have been like for Grant clansmen to navigate the Spey, Phil and I are going to kayak the 5 miles downstream from Fochabers to Kingston at the mouth of the river.
So, Phil, we're about to retrace part of the route of the great floaters, but of course, in those days, they would have been going down the river on a raft of logs and not using a canoe.
No, I'm sure they were turning their grave looking at us wusses. Right, well, here we go then.
Here we go. So going the wrong way.
Right. Whoops!
Well, I don't really think that was the most impressive display, but the guys who were doing this for real would have had a much more dangerous job because they were negotiating tons and tons of logs at the same time.
So what we're going to do, Phil, in a sense, is make our own raft. We're going to go downstream two abreast.
OK, sounds a good plan.
It's impossible to recreate the job that these men did, but it's clear that it must have taken a lot of skill to steer a raft of logs downstream.
And that large rock we see ahead of us, is that going to present an interesting challenge?
Well, it could. It could, yeah.
This is where the logs would have eventually turned up.
Yep, this is Kingston, and this is Journey's End, after a long, long haul for the floaters.
By the mid-1700s, Kingston had a thriving shipbuilding industry that would prosper for nearly 200 years. But sadly today, there is little record of the 500 ships that were built with wood from the Grant Forests and launched here into the Spey. The man charged with the unenviable task of overseeing this dangerous job was given the even more unenviable title of Chief Floater. One of the most famous Grant floaters was a legendary character called Alastair Moore, who was also the clan champion. Thanks to his military and commercial prowess, Alastair Moore is one of a handful of ordinary clansfolk to be immortalized in a unique series of paintings commissioned by the Grants.
One of the most frustrating things about this period of history is that there are very few paintings of even the most significant of clan chiefs. At a time when only the great and the good were immortalised in canvas, it's incredible and very lucky for us that the Grants commissioned these paintings at all.
Sadly, the collection has been broken up and is no longer in Grant hands. But the most iconic image of the whole series hangs in the National Museum of Scotland. Art historian Hugh Cheap believes this picture, called The Piper of the Laird of Grant, paints a captivating portrait of clan life.
For me, this is one of the national treasures. This is a fantastic item. This is highly symbolic of the historical importance of the Gaeltacht and of Gaelic society and the clan chieftains and the whole paraphernalia of clan life. The individuality just shines out of it. The man's face, I think, has been very carefully painted by the artist Richard Waite. And behind it, you have the details, the coat of arms on the banner here, the castle, the head house of the family or clan. Here was the clan at its most powerful, at its most confident, and its most assertive. It brings us back to that moment of the end of the 17th and the beginning of the 18th century and before the destruction of the late 18th century. So we have none of the reflection of the disasters which were to visit the Highlands later on.
And disaster was indeed to follow. The family were about to become embroiled in events that would forever blight the reputation of the clan chief, Ludovic Grant.
Just after the failed Jacobite Rebellion of 1745, Inverness became the setting for one of the most shocking episodes in clan history. The chief of Clan Grant handed his own people over to the victorious government forces, breaking one of the fundamental rules of clan kinship.
The Grants had secured and maintained their place in Scotland's hierarchy by always making sure they were on the winning side. So when the Jacobite cause reared its head, it's little surprise that Chief Ludovic Grant had no interest in supporting Bonnie Prince Charlie's attempt to regain the throne for the deposed Stuarts. Ludovic Grant chose to back the government side and the new Hanoverian monarchy.
By the time of the last rising, the Grants would have lost whole scale if the Stuarts had come in, because the Grants had sought to profit from the forfeited estates of previous Jacobite risings. So the Grants were people who had profited from the defeats of Jacobites.
While Clan Chief Ludovic Grant asserted his position to be pro-government, in practice, his tactic during the rebellion of 1745 was to lie low. He was, however, anxious to ensure that his clan was seen to be on the right side, and so he sent clear instructions to his clansmen not to support the Jacobites. The vast majority of Grants obeyed their chief, but one side of the clan chose to fight for Bonnie Prince Charlie. The Grants of Glenmoriston and Glenurquhart are celebrated in folklore for their loyal service to the Jacobite cause. But their own clan chief was not so impressed. Historian Seamus Grant has investigated the story of the clansmen who dared to disobey their chief.
He prevented all but a handful of the Strathspey men from coming out in the Jacobite side, but the Glenmoriston men and the Glenurquhart men came out en masse on the Jacobite side.
What happened to these Grants when the Jacobite rebellion failed?
Ludovic Grant promised the men of Glenurquhart and Glenmoriston protection should they hand themselves over to him. Over 80 of the men of Glenurquhart and Glenmoriston came out to meet Ludovic Grant. He marched them to Inverness, and on the 22nd of May, they were sent in a prison ship out of Inverness Harbour down to London. They languished there for quite some time, and then they were actually sent out without any trial to Barbados as slaves.
As slaves?
As slaves. There was over 80 sent out there. By 1749, there was only 19 alive, and only 7 actually lived to return to the Highlands.
How did ordinary Grant clanspeople react to the betrayal of their chief?
There's a curse survived from that time. Oh, young Laird of Grant, may God's retribution be great upon you. May the crying of the fatherless children prevent you from entering Christ's heaven.
Certainly wasn't loved.
Most certainly not, no.
They are a clan who's determined to succeed at all costs. If that means sacrificing clansmen because some are Jacobites or they stand in the way of economic change, so be it.
The Grant chief feared the actions of his rebellious clansmen might reflect badly on him, and so betrayed his own people to protect his position. But there can be little doubt that leading members of the Grant family were well aware that Ludovic's actions cast the clan in an unflattering light. Here in Register House are the Grant family papers. They give a fascinating insight into how the family felt about their compromised reputation.
Now, this document here is a rewriting of history, and it refers to the notorious incident when the clan chief was accused, publicly in many ways, of betraying his own clansmen. They're very keen to point out that no such betrayal ever took place. Instead, it says here, Mr. Grant's anxiety for his clansmen arose from the fact that through some misunderstanding, they had been treated not as persons who had surrendered, but as prisoners of war, and had been placed amongst those confined on board the King's ships, where they endured great suffering, and who were afterwards transferred to Tilbury Fort. Now, this is very significant. We're not talking about betrayal here. We're talking about a misunderstanding. And I think this shows, perhaps more than anything else, that the Grants were obviously very sensitive to how they were perceived.
After the failed Jacobite rebellion, the Grants' position as staunch supporters of the new Hanoverian dynasty was confirmed. The family were eager to be thoroughly anglicised, and so they decided to send the sons of the leading members of the family south for their education. The first Grant chief to be educated in England was James, the 8th Baronet. Graduating from Cambridge, James went on a grand tour of Europe, visiting Geneva, Rome, and Naples, and was so inspired by these experiences that on his return to Speyside, he commissioned Scotland's leading artist of the time, Gavin Hamilton, to produce this magnificent painting, Achilles lamenting the death of Patroclus. Sir James had become a man of the world and wanted to bring change and improvement to his estates. In 1765, he announced the establishment of a new town in Speyside, which would provide housing and employment for clanspeople.
With its neat granite houses and elegant town square, Granton-on-Spey was considered a success story and earned for its founder the title the Good Sir James Grant, a benevolent laird doing his best to improve the lot of the people. But although it seems at first glance to have been a philanthropic project, the truth is more complex.
Historian Alastair Ross has discovered fascinating evidence about James Grant's motives for establishing this Highland new town. In the same way that settlements were used to civilize Native Americans, Grant hoped his planned community would tame the unruly Scottish Highlanders.
Everyone knows that Sir James Grant is the founder of Granton-on-Spey, but another major influence on this was William Lorimer, who was the tutor to Sir James for most of his early years. In 1758, Lorimer travelled to America, and while he was there, he came across many of the new settlements and townships that had been created there by the settlers. When Lorimer returned to Scotland, he took many of the ideas and the things he'd seen in America back home with him, because Lorimer saw a direct connection between the Native Americans and how they'd been civilised and the Native Highlanders. Basically, he viewed both as barbaric peoples.
He was comparing them both in degrees of barbarity.
Barbarity, yes.
Right. Great.
He suggests to Sir James Grant it would be a good idea to build a town in Strathspey where the Grant Highlanders could be settled, where they could be civilised, where they could indulge in new forms of work like weaving. It's all about civilising people, educating them. Educating them in what it means to be British. And of course, this fitted in beautifully with the plan the British government had for civilising the Highlands. Because if you civilised the Highlands and the Highlanders, then the likelihood of there being yet another Jacobite rebellion lessened.
This is really a cultural reformation.
It is, very much so. A huge cultural reformation.
Nearly 250 years after the establishment of Granton, the town remains one of the most visible monuments to the Grants' determination to modernise and improve Scotland.
The Grants are successful because they maintain themselves on the right side politically and they grasp opportunities in empire, probably more than any other clan or family.
Well, the Grants are really just a prime example of how the major families succeeded in generating new wealth. How was it done? Black slavery.
Maybe it's difficult in Scotland to love people who are successes, and the Grants therefore will not be loved.
It seems to me as if the story of Clan Grant is one of contradictions. Their chiefs were great men of the Gaelic world, yet they betrayed their own people. They made a fortune from slavery and reinvested in the Highlands, and they were great patrons of Gaelic art and culture, yet they sought to reshape Highland society on a southern model. But in all of this, we shouldn't forget the price paid by the ordinary members of the clan, or those Africans who were sold into slavery.